So we're starting today the topic of derivatives, which is one of the two main topics of this course, derivatives and integrals. And the first thing we're going to start with is maybe the closest to the single variable case, and that is curves. So I want to remind you that when we have a curve, even a curve in three-dimensional space, so maybe something that looks like this. Okay, so I'm indicating this interchange, making this indicate that part of it is going behind and part of it is going in front, but it's just a curve in three-dimensional space. And remember that a curve is given by three functions. So the x is a function of t, the y is a function of t, and z is a function of t. We call this a parametrization of the curve, where t is between two values, and it could be between minus infinity and infinity, if it's an infinite curve. Okay, so everybody remembers this, right? And we did several examples. Now, the way we're gonna denote curves today, so here's our here are our axes in three-dimensional space. And what we're going to do is we're going to denote, so every point on the curve is of this form, right? Every point on the curve is of this form. When we start here, it is when t equals a, and we end here where t equals b. What we're going to do is we're going to denote this point by a vector starting at the origin, which we're going to call r of t. So r of t is a vector whose components are precisely these. So r of t is the vector x of t in the I component plus y of t in the j component plus z of t in the k component. So this is a vector. And as t ranges between a and b, r of t kind of traces the points along the curve. Do you see that? Everybody? Okay, so t ranges between a and b. So this is just another way, a different way of expressing the exact same idea. Good, everybody? You're still sleepy. Okay, so what we want to talk about now is the tangent line, which is what we think of when we say derivative in single variable calculus. So let me do a quick reminder. In single variable calculus, when we had a function, so this is back to good old Calc 1, when we had a function, and the way we define, let's say, the derivative at this point here, maybe let's take a point where the slope is more evident. So maybe at this point here, the way we defined it was to take secant lines. It's easy to calculate slopes of secant lines connecting two points. And then taking the slopes of secant lines as the secant connects to a point which is closer and closer to the point we're looking at. Do you remember this idea? And then the limit of these slopes, so the slopes were given by f at x minus f at x0. So here's x0, this is the point we're looking at, and then the endpoint of the secant we're calling x, and the slope of the secant line is precisely this, right? The difference in the y values of the two points divided by the difference in the x values of the two points. And the limit as x goes to x0 is precisely what we called the slope of the tangent line and denoted it by f prime. Does everybody remember this? Okay. So this is precisely what we want to do now. So let's maybe indicate the tangent line itself here. So this is just the slope of the tangent line, and the tangent line we can find using the point. So a line with this slope that goes through this point, right? That was the idea. Back to this drawing here, I want to do exactly the same thing. So suppose I want to calculate the slope. I want to find the tangent line to this curve at this given point. So now this point, I'm going to call T0. So this is the point that corresponds to the value T0. And I want to find the tangent line at this point. Okay, do you agree that there is a tangent line? Okay, and the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to take, let me move this to the other side so it's not in my way. So this is R of T0. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take a different point on the curve, maybe here. And this is going to be R of T. Okay? And I can connect these two points with a secant. Okay? And I can find the vector connecting these two points. Right? What's the vector going to be? So the vector is going to be the difference between R of T, this vector, and R of T0, this vector. That's going to be this vector. Let's call it, maybe temporarily, let's call it delta R. That's this vector. Do you agree? It's the secant vector. Do you agree? Okay. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this T value and get it closer and closer and closer to T0. So now I'm going to take a point which is closer to the point T0. I'm going to take the secant vector to this point, and then to this point, and exactly the same phenomenon that I did in the single variable case. Is the idea clear? Okay. And in the limit of these vectors is going to be the tangent vector. Okay. But there's a little twist here, something that you have to pay attention to. If we're taking limits of vectors, if I'm looking at these secant vectors, their lengths are getting smaller and smaller, right? So if I look at the limit as I tend to this point, the vector I'm going to get here is going to be the zero vector. Do you agree? Okay. So I have to fix that by a certain scaling, and that's what I'm going to do. So this vector, this vector has a given length, which is determined by these two points, but I'm going to divide it by a certain scalar. I'm going to scale it, okay? So let me write that on a different board. So I'm going to define, so delta R that we wrote before is going to be really R of T minus R of T0. That's without scaling. So this is vector. This is a vector in the direction of the secant or the chord connecting the points R of T and R of T0. Do you agree? Okay. Now I'm going to divide it by delta t, where delta t is simply, so maybe let's write it like this, it's R of t minus R of t0, and delta t is just t minus t0. Do you agree that this is still a vector in the direction of the secant? I just divided it by some scalar. Do you agree? I took a scalar multiple of it. Okay, so this is still a vector in the direction of the secant. Good? And this thing is, so these are vectors, I can check their components. So this is nothing more than x of t minus x of t0 divided by t minus t0. This is the I component of this thing, plus y of t minus y of t0 divided by t minus t0. That's the j component of this, plus z of t minus z of t0 divided by t minus t0. That's the k component of this vector. Do you agree? Good? Now, what happens as t tends to t0? Okay. As t tends to t0, well, the vector tends to the zero vector. We discussed that. But it's also scaled by a smaller and smaller. It's divided by a smaller and smaller number. So this ratio, it's kind of a 0 over 0 situation. Do you see that? And a 0 over 0 situation could have a limit. And we know what the limit is. What's the limit of this thing as t tends to 0? Now x is just a single variable function of t. Right. So as t tends to 0, the limit of this thing is nothing other than the derivative of x at the point t0. Do you agree? By definition. That's the I component plus the derivative of y at the point t0. That's the j component plus the derivative of z at t0. That's the k component. Does everybody see that? Okay, these are single variable functions in each component. Each component is a single variable function. And this is precisely the limit of this as t goes to t0 is precisely the derivative of z. Yes?
Should it be t
close to t0? To t0, yes. Thank you very much. T tends to t0, or you can write as delta t tends to 0. That's equivalent. Thank you. Yeah. Good? Okay. Now this, we're going to call, the name for this is going to be, we're going to denote this by r prime at t0. And it's a vector. Okay? So r prime at t0 is precisely the derivative of r at t0. Okay? And what did we get here? We got a vector. Okay, let's go back to the drawing for 1 second. What we got is a vector that is tangent to this curve. It's hard to see. Let's erase this. It's hard to see the picture because there's a lot of stuff on it. But this is precisely a vector tangent to the curve at this point. Okay? Clear? Okay. Now, I want to, so just like in the single variable case, you know that if what you're describing, if r of t describes the displacement of a particle, okay, or the location of some moving object, then the derivative, what does it describe?
Change.
Right. The rate of change, which we call velocity. Okay, so now there's a certain distinction here. So let's say a few remarks. So the first remark is r prime of t is the velocity. If r of t is the location, is the location of a particle in terms of time, okay, and the length of r prime of t, the size of the velocity, do you know what we call that? Right, it's just called speed. Okay, that's when r describes the location. Clear? Okay, so note that this is a number, okay, and it doesn't see the direction anymore. Okay, so when you say I'm driving at 60 miles per hour, it doesn't say in which direction you're going. Okay, whereas the velocity is a directional vector. Okay, it has a direction. So that's one remark. We denote. So in some instances, it would be useful to discuss the unit vector in the direction of the tangent, and usually it's denoted by t hat. So t hat is the r prime of t divided by the length of r prime of t. Okay, remember what we call this thing? Yeah, it's a unit vector, that's what that had, but this operation that we did here, we called normalizing the vector. Remember that? Okay, so it's a normalized vector. And some terminology a point t0, a value t0, for which r prime at t0 exists and is not equal to 0 is called a regular point. Okay? Is called regular. These are the good points. Okay, you will see this terminology of regular, and the counterpart, which I'm going to write in a second, is called singular. That terminology shows up in many, many places in math. Sometimes they're completely unrelated one to another. And regular is when stuff is okay and good, and singular is when weird phenomena happen. Okay, so a regular point is when the particle is moving, and it has a velocity and a speed, and everything's okay. Okay, it's kind of a smooth point along the path. Okay. If r prime at t0 either doesn't exist, or is 0, then t0 is called singular. A singular point. We'll see examples, but intuitively, when would you expect, what do you expect to see at points where this derivative doesn't exist? It's obvious that it cannot exist, right? It's defined as limits of single variable functions derivatives, and you know that not every function has a derivative at every point, right? So what do you expect to see? What is the geometry you expect to see at singular points? Geometrically, tell me what you expect. When I draw a curve and a point which is singular, what do you expect me to draw? Sure. Exactly. You expect to see some form of cusp in the curve. Do you agree? And then the tangent is not defined. It's not clear what's going on at that point. Okay, clear? We'll see examples. We'll see that this is exactly what happens. Okay, that there's... it's a bit more subtle, but that's the basic thing you should expect to see. Cusps, where... there's no tangent. Okay, clear? Okay. And one last remark. This is going to take us back to the very original drawing that we had. Remember that the curve is given by a certain parametrization, right? And also recall that for a specific curve, there can be many different parametrizations, right? We saw examples. So, for example, if we have t and t squared, even in the plane, a planar curve, if x is t and y is t squared, that's going to give you the same thing as if x is sine of t and y is sine of t squared. Right? Remember those examples? So, the curve is given by a parametrization, but the derivative, r prime of t, was dependent on what this parametrization was, right? It was the derivatives of the functions that prescribe the curve, okay? So the statement is that r prime of t depends on r of t, depends on the parametrization that we chose for the curve, okay? And if we choose different parametrizations, we'll get different things for r prime of t, okay? And we'll see in examples what that means, what that could imply. So that's the last remark I want to write before we actually do some examples. So remark number four, R prime at a point T0 depends on R of T, on the parametrization that we chose. And recall that parametrizations are not unique. Okay? And following this, we say that a curve is smooth, that's the term. Did you use this word in Calc 1 for a function that, okay, good. So we say that a curve is smooth if it has some parametrization, anyone, parametrization. This word is too long. Parametrization for which R prime of T0 exists and is non-zero for every T. So for every T0. Okay? So you take a curve, maybe the parametrization that you happen to choose would have points like this, where it is zero, okay? If there exists any parametrization, one, such that in that parametrization, R prime of T always exists and is always non-zero, then we say that the curve is smooth, okay? Let's do example to see how this can happen or not happen in all these things. So you should expect that if a curve has a cusp in it, no parametrization can undo that. We won't be able to find a parametrization for a curve with a cusp that would suddenly make it smooth. That would not fit the term smooth, right? But there could be a curve that seems smooth, looks smooth, for which we can find the parametrization where R prime of T is going to vanish. Okay, so that's what we're gonna need to be able to find a good parametrization for every curve. Okay, examples. So the first example, let's look at the curve, which is given by, it's going to be a planar curve, which is given by T and absolute value of T. Remember that if the y-coordinate is just a function of the x-coordinate, then we can easily draw the curve, right? X is just T, you can call it X, and y is some f of T, and we can draw the graph of f of T, right? So this curve looks, the graph of this curve, and it's a planar curve, there are only x and y components. Well, I have to tell you where t ranges, so between negative 1 and 1. So this curve just looks like this. Do you agree that this is the curve? Everybody? Okay. Now, do you see the cusp at this point 0, right? So this is the point x, y equals 0, and it corresponds to t equals 0, right? Do you agree? This point. So we should expect that whatever we define now is going to indicate that somehow, and it does. So what is r prime of t? R prime of t, we have to take the derivative of each component. What's the derivative of t? 1. So for every t, the derivative of t is 1. That's a non-issue. But for the y component, what's the derivative of absolute value of t? It's negative 1 if t is negative, it's 1 if t is positive, and it doesn't exist at t equals 0. Do you agree? And a short way of writing it is absolute value of t divided by t, for example. So do you agree that when t is positive, this thing is just t over t, so it's just 1. When t is negative, this is negative t over t, so it's negative 1. And when t is 0, it's not defined. Do you agree? Okay, so this is the tangent vector, okay? This is the tangent vector for every t, which is not 0. And for t equals 0, there is no tangent vector, because this thing doesn't exist. Do you agree? Okay, so no tangent vector for t equals 0, which is precisely this point here. Clear? Okay, so this is a singular point, and this is not a smooth curve. Clear, everybody? Say yes. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay, let's do another example. Let's erase this, maybe. So the first example was rather obvious, but let's do now something a bit more interesting. Well, it's going to look very naive at first, but then we're going to change it a bit. So here's the curve, TT. What would this look like? Again, let's assume that T is between negative 1 and 1. So what would this curve look like? It's just a curve like this. Do you agree? Okay. And what is the tangent, r prime of t, is just 1, 1, right? 1, 1 is a vector precisely in this direction, and the vector 1, 1 at any point points in the direction of the tangent to this curve. Okay, so everything fits in nicely. Do you agree? Everybody? Okay. But now, so, well, let's call it example 3, but it's related to example 2. Let's look at the curve given by the parametrization. So let me just add here, this is for every t. Right? There's no problem with this parametrization. Let's look at the curve given by t cubed, t cubed. And again, we're going to let t range between 1 and negative 1. And let's figure out what we're getting here. When t is negative 1, we're getting negative 1, negative 1. Do you agree? So we're getting this point here. When t is 1 at the other end, we're getting 1, 1. So we're getting this point here. And in between, we're running along the line x equals y. The x component and the y component are equal. So do you agree that this curve looks exactly the same as the one we had in example 2? Do you see that? It's just a different parametrization of the same curve. Okay, good. But now something interesting happens. If we look at this parametrization of the same curve, what do we get? So r prime of t is now 3t squared, 3t squared. Do you agree? And what happens at the point 0? When t equals 0, we get the 0 vector. That's not a good tangent because the 0 vector does not have a direction, right? So that's why we excluded r prime t equals 0 from calling it a regular point. We called it a singular point because it's not defined, right? Even though the zero vector has no direction. It doesn't prescribe a tangent line. Do you agree? Okay. So this is true. So for any t non-zero, we get a tangent. We have a tangent vector, which is not zero, right? But at t equals zero, r prime of zero is the zero vector, which doesn't have a direction, and therefore t equals zero is a singular point for this parametrization. Do you agree? Okay. So if this somehow indicates the movement of a particle along this line, at the point zero, it comes to a stop. Okay, the speed is zero, and then it starts moving again. Do you understand? Good? Okay. So the what you should understand from these two examples is that this is clearly a smooth curve. If the word smooth is going to make sense, this is smooth, right? But the parametrization can be misleading. We can find the parametrization for which it looks singular. It doesn't look smooth because there's a point where the derivative vanishes. Clear? Okay. And here, since we know how to draw the curve, if somebody would give you this curve and ask you, is it smooth? You would say, of course it's smooth, and then you would find this parametrization and say, here you go, here's a parametrization where r prime of t is never zero and exists always, and it's a smooth curve. Okay? But if somebody just gave you this parametrization and you didn't know how the curve looked, then you would say, oops, maybe it's not a smooth curve. Okay? So whenever you get a curve in terms of parametrization, you have to be careful. If you have points where the derivative is zero, that doesn't necessarily mean that that there's a geometric unsmoothness at that point. It may just be that the parametrization that you chose or that you were given is not a good parametrization in this sense. Clear, everybody? Okay, so maybe let's summarize what we just said. Let's write it here. So, a curve, I'm going to do it, can have a bad parametrization, in the sense that it is smooth, but the parametrization doesn't reveal that. Okay, clear? It could have misleading parametrizations, just like this. So this is the simplest curve you can have in mind, and you can see that it has a parametrization for which it looks not smooth. Clear? Is this issue clear? Everybody? Okay, so the last thing I want to write is so what we found, r prime of t is called the tangent vector, but we also have the tangent line, right? So let's write that. R prime of t is the tangent vector at the point t. The tangent line is given by, so we first have to assume if r prime of t, let's say at a point t0, is non-zero, so exists and is non-zero, therefore it's a real vector, it has a direction, then the tangent line tangent line to the curve. This is not good English. The line tangent to the curve at the point r of t0 is given by, so this is going to be an equation of a line, and let's write it in this form. L of t equals r at t0 plus t minus t0 r prime at t0. This should really remind you of the equation of a tangent in single variable calculus, right? So change r to f and t to x, so the tangent to the function f of x at the point x0 is f of x0 plus x minus x0, f prime and x0. Do you remember that? Okay, that's precisely. So y equals. But now it's going to be a line. A line has three components, right? Do you see the three components hiding here? Okay, so the x component is x at t0 plus t minus t0, x prime at t0. The y component, good, everybody? Okay, so this is the equation of the line, the equation of the line tangent to the curve. Okay? Okay, so this is kind of our way into the topic of derivatives, okay? Because this is kind of easy. Easy in the sense that it's really the exact same idea of a tangent line to a single variable function, okay? To the graph of a single variable function, except that now I'm allowing, and in fact, all the examples that we did were graphs of single variable functions, but now it could work for any curve in space, okay? You get a tangent at every point. What we want to do now is move on to discussing the concept of the derivative for a totally different geometric object that we've been looking at, which are scalar functions of two or more variables. Okay, so the graph of the function is something like this, right? And we want to understand what are derivatives, what are tangents, what do we mean by those things, and that's coming up next.